Debate is raging after swimming's world governing body, FINA, banned most transgender athletes from competing in the women's elite competition. FINA plans to establish an open category for trans athletes. It's the strictest policy introduced by Olympic sports organisations. Four-time Olympic gold medal swimmer Kate Campbell supported the move.
My role is also to stand up here, having asked our world governing body, FINA, to investigate, deliberate and uphold the cornerstone of fairness in elite women's competition.
Transgender athlete Hannah Mouncey is an international handballer and an Australian rules footballer and joins us now. Hannah, what did you make of FINA's decision?
Look, it was an interesting one. Sort of came from nowhere. Normally you hear about these things a bit beforehand, but a blanket ban is very, very strong and I think really unnecessary because it's painting something which a lot of people have acknowledged is a very grey area and decided that it's black and white. And that's it's a really difficult place to be in, particularly deciding that basically if you haven't transitioned by the time you're 12, you can't compete. All I can say is it's interesting. It's not great.
Not quite a blanket ban because, as you say, there's the 12-year-old limit. And also they're creating... they're proposing to create an open category for trans athletes. Do you have any idea how that would work?
I don't think it would work, if I'm honest. And part of the reason is if it's an open category, I don't know that trans people are actually going to be able to compete, for one, because all that's going to happen is, say, for example, you know, Australia has first and second qualify for the 100 metres at our national championships. They're just going to send third and fourth and compete in that. I mean, that's what I would do. But also... trans athletes, you know, who are they going to compete against? There's not that many of us. Trans people have been really, really made to feel as though sport's not a welcoming space for the last, you know, for as long as we've been around, really. And so I don't know in this instance, Leah Thomas, who I'm sure, you know, let's not beat around the bush. That's who this ruling is there for. She's not going to have anyone to compete against in all likelihood. So there's a lot of reasons why it wouldn't work, but those two are the two that stand out to me.
So Hannah, FINA says this is based on fairness and on the science. Do you accept that a trans athlete does have an advantage over other competitors?
No, not at all. And I think people... Look, the thing with this debate, and it shouldn't even be a debate, is it's been very politicised. If it came down to the actual science of it, there'd be no debate and trans people would be competing. And you can look at the IAAF and what they've done. And, you know, they did research into testosterone deprivation in regards to Carsten Semenya, who's intersex. And what they came back with was that testosterone deprivation provided such an impact on her performance that they essentially said to her, you know, if you want to run, you've got to lower your testosterone, but then you're fine. The same research, if you apply it to trans people, they turn around and say the data isn't in.
Well, that takes us to the athletes themselves. Kate Campbell, who we'll speak to a little later, she was the flag bearer, Australian champion swimmer. She herself says that she believes this decision's the right decision. When it comes from the athletes, does that make a difference for you?
It doesn't, because I would ask how much they actually know about what happens to a trans person's body when they go through a transition process. And also in regards to Kate and the swimmers as well, I actually, during the election, because they were obviously asked a lot, I reached out to a mutual contact of both of ours and offered to speak to any of them to know more. That offer was never taken up, so I don't know, you know, exactly who Kate's spoken to, but I think it would really help speaking to athletes who have been through it. Trans people are never included in the discussion, really, when it comes to policy debate or anything like that. And so until we are, you know, athletes who, look, are excellent at what they do and are being asked for an opinion, but I don't think they really know what they're talking about a lot of the time, and nor should they. You know, if I wasn't trans, I wouldn't know what I'm talking about either. And that's not an expectation on anyone. But I think we need to take it with a grain of salt when we listen to those sort of opinions.
You seem fairly certain in your own mind on the biological or scientific argument. At the same time, you reference that bodies, some of the sporting bodies are saying the science isn't yet in. Why are you so certain if the science isn't in?
I've been through it. And I'm not saying that the science isn't in. The sporting bodies are. And I think that's a key difference. You know, for me, I can tell you, you know, November 2015, before we went over to Qatar to compete at the Olympic qualifiers for handball, I was benching 150, squatting 200 and cleaning 140, and that's all kilos. Within 12 months, my bench press had gone down to about 60. The squat had gone down to about 70. and the clean had gone down to about 60 or 70 again. It's a pretty big drop in 12 months. But also, how do we apply any of this science, or how do we look at people's bodies? You know, I use myself as an example. I think it's on the record. I am, you know, 6'2", quite big. I'd be an awful gymnast, and I'd be an awful marathon runner, an awful diver. So are we going to tell trans people that they can only play sports that they're not going to be good at? You know, it's a real problem, and I think we need to look at it as a whole and not look at it in such a simple way as we are at the moment.
Hannah, thanks very much for your time tonight. Appreciate it.
No worries at all.